Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? In the southern sky, about 2 hours after sunset, we have the constellation of Leo straddling the meridian. That is the line that goes from north through the zenith all the way to the south. And just above there is a constellation that I highlighted on Facebook and Twitter called Leo Minor, which is a rather dim constellation composed of mostly fourth magnitude stars at the brightest, kind of between where Leo is here and Ursa Major is up here. So when we pull up our constellation lines, we can see there's Leo Minor just below the feet of the Big Bear and above the head of where Leo is at. I want to point out this constellation because while Stellarium does a very good job of pointing out where deep sky objects are, such as galaxies and globular clusters and star clusters, it doesn't do a very good job of pointing out where good double stars are unless you actually click on them. But unless you click on a whole bunch of different stars, you don't know where to look for them. So I want to point you at a number of really good double stars. We're going to start in Leo and move our way up into Leo Minor. So we'll actually begin with some stars that you can look at with just simple binoculars or your finder scope on your way to Leo Minor. And then we'll finish up with those ones that we'll want to be able to look at through a telescope. But I do want to start by talking about something that's a little sciencey. And if we look at the types of stars that we would see out in the night sky, there's a diagram of them. And if you just remember the moniker, oh, be a fine girl or guy, kiss me, that can help you remember the stars as they go from hottest at O and B class down to the coolest at K and M class. We're going to look at some A and F and K class stars mostly. So you can see how the temperature range is different. We're looking at the 8,000 to 10,000 degrees in the A class. And then down at K, we're looking at just 3,500 to 5,000. And then M class at just 2,500 to 3,500. So much cooler. And you'll see the color difference. And that's what I kind of want to point out to you as we go through some of these stars. We begin with the bright first magnitude star Regulus at kind of that elbow or maybe paw of Leo, and as we zoom in a little bit on there, we're going to see that there's some other bright stars that kind of form a backwards question mark shape, and we're going to use that to aim towards Leo Minor coming up. But beginning at Regulus, we want to jump just two stars, so from here to there and then to this one, which is Algeba, and that star is a K-class star, so that's one of those cooler ones. But right nearby, and you can actually see it even at this distance, is 40 Leonis. Now that's an F-class star. Now that doesn't seem like a big difference. You're just going from F and then G's in the middle and then K. But when you look at these through binoculars, I personally saw a really distinct color difference. Like you could really see the orangey of that K-class star and actually the F-class 40 Leonis looked rather bluish to me. So it was because it's dimmer, I think you kind of really saw that color difference. You don't see those on Stellarium very well. There's some coloration of those, but the stars really tend to have more color contrast when they're close to each other, and binoculars are a great way to see this particular color combination. Now if we go one more star hop away, and you can actually see pretty much all these in a binocular field of view because they're only about 4 degrees apart, we're gonna look up here at Adhifara, which is also 36 Leonis. And if we zoom in just a little bit, we can see that there's some other stars happening here. There's 35 Leonis, very close by, right there. So though that's a G-class star, 35 is an F-class star. So those are pretty similar. And then down here, a little further away, which you can split that fairly easily with your binoculars, is going to be another F-class star, 39 Leonis. That makes a nice set of triple stars to look at together. But I think the nicest pair is probably these two, 35 and 36. You should be able to split that with binoculars, even those look very close right there. They're far enough away that you should be able to find that. Now, what we're gonna do to get up into Leo Minor is we're gonna follow a line going from Regulus through 35 like this. Now you can see that's a little over 11 degrees. You're gonna go a similar distance, the same direction. Like that. So you're just going to make two jumps and just kind of get a feel for how far that is when you go through there, because you've got these two stars to guide you to this one, but then you don't really have a whole lot of stars up here. But what you will find when you get up into this area is there's going to be a little triplet of stars like that. 1, 2, 3. And you should be able to find those without any problem using binoculars or a finder scope. These two will be much more difficult to see in binoculars, but that's where your telescope comes in. So we're going to center that and look at these. And you can see that makes kind of a, I guess, a skewed sort of smiley face. So if that's maybe our smile, and then there's two eyes a little shifted off to the side like that. These particular stars, now, by the way, this is under 1 degree field of view, so you might have a little bit more space if you've got a wide field of view with a lower power eyepiece, and especially a shorter focal length telescope. This may also be reversed for you if you're looking through a reflector. This particular view I've got looking through a Maxitov Cassegrain, I believe is what I have this set at. Yes, Matt Cass. So that is going to be similar to our refractor, but a reflector would give you a little bit different view. So when we look at these stars, there are some very different colors that should be apparent. So we've got 27, which is an A-class star. We have 28, which is a K-class star. So you should see that color difference for sure, because this one's going to be much hotter than that star. So we're looking at something that's in the 8,000 to 10,000 degree range here, and we're looking at only 35 to 4,500 there. And then back over to an A-class star here. Now you'll notice that this star, 30, and if we go back over to 27, that's 242 light years away. Those are similar distance, so it's good possibility that since those two stars are both A-class stars and they're at a similar distance, they may have been related at some point. And if I did my calculations correctly, although they are different distances, the difference in width between them is about 2.3 light years, if you're interested in that, because the split here, angular-wise, if we go across there, is just 35 arc minutes. So fairly narrow, but for a telescope, that's easy to do in a wide field of view. Now, when we look up at these stars, our little eyes for our smiley face, we have this star, which is a 7th magnitude star. It's a K-class star. Now that's in that 35 to 4,500 range. And this star should be cooler because it's M-class. So now we're looking at 2,500 to 3,500. See if you can notice the color difference of that. This one is actually a pulsating variable star, although it doesn't vary by very much, only 6.9 to 7.0. So you might not notice any difference if you looked at that over time, but you may see the color difference. So let me know if you do see that color difference. But here's a little smiley face that you can check out in a rather dim and typically overlooked constellation just above a much more prominent constellation in the southern sky at this time of year. That's all for this week. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.